Okay, we are live. So thank you all for joining for another session of the NSF Wednesday Colloquium. And it's my privilege to actually have the Dean of Natural Sciences Faculty at TIFR, Professor Kalaburan Maithi, who has kindly agreed to give a colloquium today. Before I give a little bit of a formal introduction to Professor Maithi, I just wanted to tell that this colloquium series is as old as TIFR itself. And for those who are joining for the first time, this always holds a special place for all TIFR crowd, scientists, students, postdocs, to get together and just listen to some very nice description of what contemporary science is bringing us, bringing us to us, the new development. So, in that vein, today we have a very, very well-known expert in electron spectroscopy who looks at correlated electron systems in condensed phase and really has strong interest in looking at physical phenomena that emerges from electron-electron correlation. Professor Kalaburan Maithi, of course, if you haven't done any work administratively, maybe you will not know him. But if you have, you have to get to his office and get his signature for almost all of the things that we know of. And today he has dressed up for the occasion. He actually has tidied up his hair. So, Professor Maithi, I welcome you for this talk. So.
Thank you, Jyotishman. So for inviting me to give this talk, it's my privilege to discuss something that we love to do all the time, and we discuss about it. So today, basically, I decided to talk about the basics of spectroscopy that we have been doing, because this is something that many people that they use this technique in various forms. So, for example, like starting from chemists, biologists, and physicists, everybody together. So, one popular name, of course, you know that it's called XPS, which is used extensively to characterize materials and so on. Of course, we can do serious physics using this kind of spectroscopy. So, I thought that let me discuss in brief the basics about the technique, and then I bring out the recent advances that we have proposed, so which is a kind of a new methodology that you can think of, that how it can help really study material properties of various complex materials. As you know that we can have a theoretical understanding of a system is one thing, but when you look at the same property in a material, of course, it gives you a complex, complete plethora of various competing phenomena, which you shouldn't have been expecting and so on. Material science is extremely rich in that sense, and studying them is pretty challenging. So what we often do is that we try to identify a certain kind of parameter and tune and see how well we can actually look at them carefully. So that has been the effort from our side. So here I have shown some of these interesting things that we have been doing. For example, as you know that these topological insulators which have been looked at recently, which shows Dirac cone, but if you are in a typical system like say BIPD and so on, which shows a Dirac cone of this kind, which is a different shape. Of course, heard about graphene, which has been studied. I think thousands of papers are coming out almost in a regular basis. This also should show a Dirac cone, but you see that it's actually, the experiment shows a completely different kind of scenario. There are nanostructures which are studied, of course, condo materials, superconductors, and so on. So So I'll give few examples today while I discuss the topic and its strength, how we can use this technique to study various material properties or to reveal actually the underlying physics of various kinds of materials. Before I get into the topic, I would like to acknowledge all my group members who has been contributing in this, because you know that this is a very challenging kind of task and you need a extremely good set of talented people working together for this. So this is the alumni of this group. You know that there are several graduate students, each of them, they are extremely talented, and because of them, this whole activity could actually materialize like the way it is today. There are several postdocs, and Anup was a postdoc, of course, till last year, so he's now moving to US for another postdoc. There are some JRFs. The present group looks like this. So these are the graduate students. These are the graduate students. So three are here located at TIFR. Tanushree is actually, she was a JRF here with us. Now she is in Slovenia. So today actually the main focus of my topic that I'll be talking at the end actually is a PhD topic for her. So she is in Slovenia now and working for this time resolved purpose. Actually the main person who has built up this is Ganesh. So I would like to specially thank him for his excellent contribution for this new thing that we are proposing. I have, of course, collaborated with many of our colleagues in the department. As you can see that almost half of them, Sampath, I think I have maximum number of papers with him, Sampath and Namizabel. So most of the materials that I use nowadays, for example, I just call Tamizabel and he kindly agrees to give it. So this kind of a nice atmosphere that helped me to flourish. Otherwise, it's very difficult because you know that good quality material is the most important thing for our kind of study. Then I had collaborations with Paolo, Suresh, Ramki also. Recently, the BIPD that we are working, it's an excellent kind of system. It was essentially suggested by Ramki. We have got excellent results for that. I'm not going to present today, but at some point maybe we'll discuss about that. Then this semiconductor nanostructures are in collaboration with Professor Milan Sangal. Most of the correlated systems I have studied are, I got the samples from Geeta Balakrishna, whom I think many of us know. And then Patnaik from JNU, he also gave us some Bi2Sc3. Chromium dioxide, of course, we worked with Nigam, which we have not published yet. I just wanted to mention specially Thomas, although we have not published anything yet, but his presence was important. He was a great theoretician who has been the founder of dynamical mean field theory and was a great friend because he visited us several times and we discussed significantly on many, many things. We work with Dennis, who is an expert in RPS. So many cases where I am not able to really go personally for doing experiments. So he actually kindly collaborates with us and we get a lot of good quality data. The time resolved studies that we have done, which I'll be actually focusing at the end and which is the main part of this topic, is done in his lab. So he is Giovanni Nino in Slovenia. They have got a beautiful setup and Ganesh actually went to his lab to do this kind of activity. So that we could realize this project because of his collaboration with us. Okay. Let me start the technique. As all of you know, photoemission spectroscopy is basically based on photoelectric effect. Sorry. Where you shine light of some energy on a material and the light is absorbed by the electrons and it comes out and then you put a detector and detect them. Just before I get into that, I just want to mention that there are three Nobel Prize actually involving this technique. One is, of course, you know that photoelectric effect was essentially explained by Einstein. And then X-ray spectroscopy was discovered by Carl Zeeman, which is an extremely powerful technique to identify elements. I mean, EDX and so on, most of these kind of things that people do to study material, identify material, actually is using this technique. And his son, Kai Zeeman, got a Nobel Prize again on X-ray photoemission spectroscopy, which is again is one of the most powerful techniques, which I'll actually explain to you today in some form, so that why it is so important. As I said, that this essentially is a photoelectric effect where the light is shined on the material and the electrons inside this material, it absorbs this light and it goes to higher energy. And if the energy of the electron is high enough so that it can overcome the binding, all kinds of binding of this material, it comes out of the material, you put a detector and detect it. So that's basically the technique. So for example, if you have an electron in these four levels, which are like atomic levels or the conduction band, so their energy will be elevated by the photon energy, so which is h nu. And now you can see that, so we use the energy, our language of energy is like this, that we assume that the Fermi level, which is the highest occupied level in a material, we assume that that is the zero of energy, not really the zero is at infinity. So whenever we talk about binding energy, we always assume that the zero of energy at the Fermi, which is the highest occupied. Of course, if an electron at the Fermi level wants to come out, it has to overcome some potential barrier, which is called the Wolff function. So that's called the vacuum level. So if an electron has an energy, anything above vacuum level are able to come out of this material and you detect. So that comes out as the kinetic energy of the electron. Now, you are actually detecting the number of electrons reaches this detector at a particular energy that we can select. So it depends on many, many objects. One is, of course, this transition probability that electron is able to go from this ground state to the excited state, which is controlled by the sigma E or cross section. So this is the term which I'll be focusing mainly in almost every slide. Okay? So the next part is called the resolution function. As you know that any experiment you do, it has a certain amount of accuracy by which it can detect that particular parameter like energy here we are detecting. So that comes as a Gaussian broadening. The third term is called the Lorentzian broadening. This comes because, as you know, that if you excite an electron, you are creating a hole here, and the electron is excited here, which is detected here. Now, this is a quantum mechanical process. Now, this procedure or the various conservation rules that we are implementing for this kind of technique is applicable as long as the hole is surviving. If, of course, the hole is not there, then the system becomes different and you cannot implement all these conservation rules that we associate to the transition, electronic transition that we talk about in this technique. So it means that the lifetime of the hole is an important factor. It comes as a Lorentzian. Similarly, the electron that comes out, that also can undergo various scattering and get lost. So then it doesn't really come out as a signal. So this electron also has a lifetime, which is actually captured by this LE. Now the fourth term is essentially it's like absorption. The lambda is mean free path. Now if you have excited an electron inside at some depth, it's not necessary that that electron will be able to come out because there are a lot of inelastic scattering happening. So if I assume that lambda is the mean free path or mean escape depth, then the fraction of the electrons excited inside the material are actually detected, which is e to the power minus x by lambda. So these are all the parameters which comes into the picture when you do electron spectroscopy and actually the density of states that we want to measure. So we have to be careful that whenever we are associating photoelectron spectra with the density of state that we are interested to look at in actually involves this many parameters which needs to be taken care of. Okay, so I'll explain one by one what are those parameters. Before that,
hello, can I ask you a quick question?
Yes, please.
What is the penetration depth above this, below the surface?
I'll show you. I'll give you a detailed plot of that. Okay.
Okay.
I have that slide. That. So I just want to point out this that mentioned here. This excitation process, the electron excitation process, is an extremely fast process. Like the time taken for an electron to go from ground state to the excited state, it happens in the attosecond. So nowadays, of course, there is a development of technology and people are building fast laser, attosecond laser is possible. And this is a science paper where they have shown that they could find out the delay of excitation of an e electron compared to the S electron, which is about 21 attoseconds. Why I mentioned here is that, so that means that the electron spectrum that we are detecting, so that process is happening so fast that this perturbation that also leads to actually disturb the material. Like you can have electron phonon excitation, electron magnon excitation. There are, vibrational, rotational, various kinds of things happening. So all those things actually happen at a time scale of the order of femtosecond. Electron-electron interaction also plays an important role, which also has a time scale of a femtosecond or sub-femtosecond. It's not so fast like attosecond. So that means that the electronic spectrum that we are recording is more like a snapshot at that moment when you have excited this electron. Okay? So it's a local electronic or spectral function that we are detecting, which is happening at an extremely fast time scale. Okay? Then, of course, this cross-section, this gives you a sensitivity to the orbital character, which I'll talk next few slides. And then the surface sensitivity, which Sanjay asked, this also I'll talk about it. So each and every aspect that I'll bring out distinctly, that is the purpose of this. So let me talk about this photovision intensity. Basically, let me focus on this sigma E. So what I'm actually looking at, sigma E can be just written in terms of Fermi's golden rule. Please don't worry about the equations that I'm showing. I'll give you, a qualitative explanation, but I'm not going to really go much more detail into the equations as such. So, but the terms will help us to understand the scenario that I am talking. So this is the Fermi's golden rule, which actually tells you what is the probability of exciting an electron from the initial state, which is psi I, to the final state, which is psi R. And A dot R is a dipole moment which comes, A is the vector potential, comes from the light that is used to perturb the system. R, of course, is the radial function. So this term I'll explain in more detail, like plays a very important role, and the Dirac delta function actually ensures the energy conservation. So what we are measuring here is that we actually measure the kinetic energy, and we know the photon energy that we are using to do the photon emission. So which is actually the difference of the final state energy minus the initial state energy, and it can be written as E binding energy plus kinetic energy plus phi. So which I have shown here in the earlier slide, like this, that this is your H nu, which is the binding energy with respect to the Fermi level, then the work function, and the remaining part is the kinetic energy. Okay. So basically, that's the energy conservation. Okay. So now we know the work function that we can determine, and kinetic energy we determine. So we know all these parameters, so that way it gives the binding energy. Now we can use momentum conservation rule, which I'll also explain how we can use it to determine the momentum of an electron inside the solid. Spin is conserved for this kind of transition. So, and spin also can be detected by photoemission spectroscopy. And then we can also detect the symmetry, which also I'll be talking, which is the main part actually of the discovery, or we can say the proposal that we have made for this technique. So what I want to say is that photoemission is a technique where you can determine energy, momentum, spin, and symmetry, all the four quantities that is required to learn the microscopic picture of a material. And the interesting thing is that you can directly probe them. So that's basically the strength of this technique. Okay. Let me go to one by one to each of the aspects that I am talking about. So look at the matrix element effect. Now, as we know, that when the electron comes out of the material, that's more like a free electron which we are detecting. So we can think of intuitively that as if this final state is not really so important, the initial state that we need to look at, okay? So that's probably is tuning the potential spectrum, which comes out from the density of states, okay? The only thing which is important here is that if the photon energy that we have used is quite high, the kinetic energy of the electron that comes out will be very high. So if it is very high, of course, it's a highly oscillating function. So it will have an overlap with psi I, which is the initial state. Now, if this one is a highly oscillating function, that will have a large contribution compared to a slowly oscillating function. Like, for example, if you take a P state, which is slowly oscillating function compared to D state. Now, if you take an overlap integral of psi f with psi I, which is P and D, so if your energy is high, which is highly oscillating, will give you a larger number compared to the number you get for P. Now, if the photon energy is low, which is a slowly oscillating function, that will give you a larger number for P compared to D, like that. So the photon emission process can be tuned by tuning the photon energy. Apart from that, we may actually ignore for the present the psi f contribution and focus on psi I. Okay. This is actually used extensively to understand certain properties, which I'll show you. This can be used for molecules as well as quantum dots or solid materials of different forms. So this one, I'm showing a valence band spectrum collected using three different photon energy. One is 21 electron volt, which is helium 1, 40 electron volt, which is helium 2, and X-ray energy, which is 1.5 Ka. Okay. And you can see the same thing looks so different. So this peak, there are several peaks, maybe four. This peak becomes more intense if you go to this energy. And in XPS, it becomes very intense. This one also is increasing with the change in photon energy, but this peak actually is almost non-existent there. So now you can actually analyze this. And since we know that the material that we are studying is a barium iridium oxide, where the valence band actually is constituted by iridium P and oxygen P, so we can actually compare the cross section. And we know, just now I explained qualitatively, that the D states will have higher cross section for XPS compared to the P state, and the reverse is at lower photon energy. So assuming that, we can say that the D contribution is here more, and here also is significant, and here this is P. Now if you take the bonding, antibonding, and non-bonding kind of scenario in a solid, so we can easily analyze and say that, okay, these are the non-bonding states from oxygen P, and this is a antibonding state, and this is a bonding state. And this easily can be associated, as you can see that here, the change in intensity is much stronger compared to this. So that means that the D contribution might be much larger here compared to this. So you can have a scenario automatically that the iridium D is here, oxygen D is here, and this is the antibonding. And like that, we can understand this. Okay. But the real thing is much more complex. So this is routinely used to study the material, electronic structure, bonding, antibonding, covalency, ionicity, and so on. Okay. But let me go into more detail. Now, see, the photoemission process, I'll again explain that in the ground state, assume that you have N electrons in the material. Now you have perturbed the system by a photon, and one electron comes out, leaving N minus electron behind. So what we do, we detect the properties of this electron which has come out of the material, so its momentum, energy, spin, and symmetry, from that, and use various conservation rules and associate those properties to the N minus 1 particle system. And we always assume that before the photo emission, the system was in the ground state. Okay. So this is the process that we use. Now, I'll show you Hamiltonian, but please don't worry. I am not going to solve anything here. So let's take a core level photovision spectrum, which is essentially extensively used for ESCA, like chemical analysis and so on, to find out valency. Like if you want to find out at which state, for example, manganese is there in a quantum dot or a zeolite and so on. So you can find use this technique and find out. So assume that I'm taking a cluster with nickel at the center and 5 oxygen around it. And I have done a photo emission of nickel 2p core level. Okay. Now I can just write down a Hamiltonian simply for this state. So it would look like this. This is a multiband Hubbard Hamiltonian. So where the energy of the d electrons, these are all related to the valence electron. Okay. I'm just explaining the Hamiltonian, but I'm not going to talk more on this. So this is the energy of a d electron, which is there in nickel. This is the energy of a p electron, which is there in oxygen. And this one is the energy required to transfer an electron from p to d. This is the term which is essentially required to transfer electron from oxygen to another oxygen. And of course, vice versa is given by Hermitian conjugate. And this one is electron-electron Coulomb repulsion. So we are only considering the Coulomb repulsion of electrons, which are there at nickel only. I'm not really talking about any correlation between the electron here and here, because that number is much smaller compared to the on-site one. This on-site one is complex enough to deal with. Now, if you do a core level photo emission, so you have knocked out an electron from nickel 2p, so you have created a hole which also has energy there. And of course, that hole also will interact with the nickel d electrons, so that will give you this. And this is the spin orbit coupling. Like if you knock out an electron from p core level, p has an orbital quantum number L1, and it has a spin s, which is half. So your total quantum, angular momentum will be L plus S or L minus S, which gives you two different kind of final state, like 3/2 and half. So L plus S is 3/2 and L minus S is half. So that gives you the spin orbit splitting. So that's the reason I've included this term. Now think of the situation like this. Now, if you did not have this electron correlation, like electrons are not interacting with each other, so they're like independent particles. Now, whether you have knocked out an electron from core level or not, it doesn't really matter to these conduction electrons because they are not interacting with each other. So your initial state Hamiltonian and final state Hamiltonian will look essentially similar, except this energy term, because the Coulomb repulsion is neglected. Now, as you know, that any Hamiltonian you solve, all the eigenstates are orthogonal to each other. So if you excite an electron from initial state psi I to psi f, since they are all looking similar to each other, so you will have only one state which will have a finite hybridization of this, and all other states are orthogonal to psi n. So you get only one peak. But you know that in any system, electrons are interacting with each other, so you cannot neglect them. So the moment you include this term, you see the final state Hamiltonian looks very different. So your eigenfunctions in the final state or excited state will be very, very different from the ground state. And each of them can have a finite overlap with psi I and gives you a peak. What I'm trying to say is that if you have electron correlation in field, I'm not talking about other aspects. There are many other aspects which can give you multiple peaks. This is one aspect which tells you that because of this, you can have multiple states which can give you a peak. Schematically, I'll just explain the scenario here. So assume that this is your ground state. Now I have part of the system by photon and knock out the electron. So this is the electron which we detect, which left behind this n minus 1 electronic states inside the sample. Now if the kinetic energy of the electron is here and this n minus state is in the ground state, okay, this gives you a sum which is h nu. Now if this one is at an excited state, eigen energy is slightly higher. Of course, the energy conservation ensures that this electron will have a lower kinetic energy. Similarly, if it goes to another excited state, this energy will be even lower. Now, from the energy conservation equation, where we use H nu equal to E binding energy plus kinetic energy plus phi. Now, since the kinetic energy we are detecting is much lower, so you get different peaks at a different binding energy. And the interesting thing is that the binding energy that you calculate for this one is actually not a more stabilized state, but it's an excited final state. Okay, so this is the difference which I'm saying. So normally, if, for example, if you look at oxygen 1s, 2s, 2p, they have a different binding energy. And accordingly, if you do photoemission, they will give you a signal and give you a peak with corresponding binding energy. But when you are doing photoemission, because of this effect, you can actually get a peak at a higher binding energy, which corresponds to an excited state. It's not a more stable state. So that way, the photoemission actually is much more complex than what we think. I'll give you a short example without going into more details. For example, think of this. This is an old work which we have done using this DD. So here, nickel is in different environment. These are, forget about the details of this. So this is a system which is NiO, where electron in a nickel can go in every direction, X and Y axis, Z axis. So that's the reason this is called a 3D system. Here, electron can go from this nickel to this one because there is oxygen here. This direction also it can go because there is oxygen here, but it cannot move in C direction. So that's the reason, although the material is a 3D material, but the electronic structure is two dimensional. Similarly, here it can move only in one direction. Here it cannot move in any direction. So you have material, depending on the structure, you have different kind of confinements. And you look at the nickel 2p gold level spectrum. You are knocking out electron only from 2p and gives you so many peaks. This is the 2p 3 by 2, as I said, that this L plus S gives you this, and this is 2p half. That we can find out from calculation also. But within 2p 3 by 2, you have many peaks. Now, if we calculate, we find out that actually what happens is that when you are knocking out an electron, if you have a final state where the nickel ore hole is screened by an electron from the neighbor. So for example, like if you knock out an electron at that side, momentarily there is a positive charge, which can be neutralized by an electron hopping from the neighbors to that side. So that's called a screened peak, which comes here, and all the others called satellite, where you have no screening. So you have different final states possible, and that gives you many peaks, okay? The most interesting things happens in cuprate superconductors, okay? Here I have shown some of the structures network where the central dot is copper and these others are oxygen. You can see that here you have a one-dimensional system. This is a different structure. These are different structure and gives you a peak. It looks so different. Even the whale screen peaks looks so funny. I mean, there are many multiple peaks are there. And what is happening here, that actually if you create a core hole at this side, for example, and an electron from this oxygen hops to this side to screen this, so you can have a situation that the electron which has hopped here, it can form a singlet with a keyhole here, which is called Chang-Reis singlet and so on. So if it forms a singlet, it gives you a separate peak compared to the situation where it has not formed a singlet. Okay? So it's a quantum mechanical system, you have all possibilities. And you can get different peaks, and from that you can study. And many people think that the Chang-Reis singlet is relevant for the superconductivity and so on. Of course, I'm not going into that. But what I'm trying to say is that this final state effect is an extremely important parameter that needs to be worried about when we understand or analyze photoemission. Okay. Now, I'll talk about the ARPES, which basically is extensively used by many people. Particularly, we have used extensively, which uses momentum conservation rule. As I said, the electron that you detect by this detector is like a free electron, so you can write it as p square by 2m, and you can calculate the momentum as square root of 2sme. It's a vector, so you put a k unit vector. Now, if you are calculating the in-plane component of momentum, so then when the electron was inside the material and outside, the in-plane component or K parallel really doesn't change. So you can say that the electron parallel component is essentially 1 by H cross. So this comes like this, is multiplied by sine theta, where theta is the emission angle, okay, with respect to surface mount. But for out-of-plane component, this won't work because the electron had to overcome some potential barrier. to come out of the material. So if I assume that that is V0, so when the electron was inside the material, the energy of that electron must have been E kinetic energy plus V0. So that we use and find out the K perpendicular. So that's the way you can find out the momentum of the electron when it was inside the material. So you know energy and you know momentum, you can plot the energy eigenfunction as a function of momentum and gives you the energy bands. That's the way you can find out. So the energy bands of any material in a solid, and which is extremely powerful tool to understand the various properties, which I'll tell you in some minutes. So since this is happening due to the detection of angle, so it's called angle resolved fluorescence spectroscopy or ARPES. There are many terminologies which are used depending on the kind of probe that you use, XPS, UPS, ultraviolet fluorescence, laser ARPES, where you can use laser light for photoemission, you can use synchrotrons and so on. I'm not going into the details of that. Let me first explain in brief this ESCA, which actually led to the Nobel Prize to Kai Zygmunt. So how to identify material? Okay, so just briefly, I'll tell you because I mean, many people actually utilizes XPS to identify material, which is essentially a method where you don't need to destroy the material, but can find out what it is. As you know, the core level peaks are actually a well-defined peaks and element specific because the binding energies are very well, I mean, you can calculate it. So here I can, this is a material where I've got a peak, several peaks. So I can actually look at the table, find out what are the binding energies for different core levels, and I can actually assign them, okay? Now, this is pretty easy. So if you want to find out what material is there in a kind of an unknown object, you can easily find out just doing the XPS. Now, if you want to find out the chemical formula, then it comes the difficulty. So as you just now I explained that this final state effect actually gives you a lot of problem. So that means you can have multiple peaks for one core level photoemission. And so now you, if you have a peak, for example, arsenic 3S or calcium, you don't even know how much energy range that needs to be used to find out the intensity under this curve. And then of course the photoemission cross section plays a big role. So what people do normally is that you find out the peak intensity area under the curve weighed by the photoemission cross section and see if you can identify the element or not. As I said, that the problem here is that we don't know exact energy range which is relevant for that kind of photoemission. And cross-section may change depending on like which material you are looking at, whether it's a molecule or solid or organic molecules and so on. The other way you can do is that you can find out the valency. As you know that if something is at a certain valency, the binding energy also will get, I mean, will be different corresponding to that valency. Like if something is, say, copper, if it is 1+ or 2+, the binding energy will be different for those kind of valency. For 2+, the knocking out an electron is more difficult because it's a positively charged kind of site. So the local potential plays a big role. But since there are multiple peaks, okay, and the materials are not purely ionic, and of course the final state effect makes it much more complex. So it's again, they brings out a lot of difficulty. So what we do is that we, of course, use both this technique, like find out the peak intensity and valency, and we can utilize judiciously and find out what is the material there. So here actually it is identified as calcium iron to arsenic 2. And then we find that there is oxygen, so which is not there in this formula. This you can find out, you can just sputter or clean inside the vacuum and you see that this guy goes away. Okay, so that way you can see that this is actually an impurity which is there on the surface like that. So this is one thing which is extensively used even nowadays to identify elements and their valency and their chemical reactivity, ionization and so on, electron affinity and so on. So there are many things that can be determined. Okay. Now let me talk about the surface sensitivity which Sanjay asked. This is the universal curve, which is of course it's published in 1979 for various materials. Now if you do photoemission, this is the kinetic energy. So you can see this is a logarithmic scale. So if you have an electron kinetic energy varying from 40 to say 100 electron volt, that gives you the minimum escape depth or penetration depth, which is about 6 to 10 angstrom. So you cannot really probe more than that. The best, so now if I assume that one layer in a solid is about 2 angstrom, so you are basically looking at top 2 to 3 layers. If you are doing photo emission using this photon energy, if you go to lower energy, of course, it goes up, because you know that the moment the kinetic energy is low, the dissipative methods like inelastic processes becomes less efficient, and the electron is able to come out of the material without much loss. So that way the mean free path goes up. Of course, if the kinetic energy is very high, it really meets the material rarely, and the scope of losing energy also low, so the penetration depth. So this is the penetration depth. These are our results. We have looked at many materials, and we found actually that this holds good even if you look at complex materials. So these are done for elements. This is, for example, oxide. This is DIPD, for example. This is calcium iron to arsenic 2, and so on. So we have done and found out actually that this holds good. So that means that the surface sensitivity is an extremely important issue. So if you want to do experiment, these are the things that one has to take into account. Because if you are doing XPS, so the X-ray kinetic energy is 1.5 keV, which is somewhere here. So it's like 20 angstrom or so. So about 10 layers you are looking at. So if you have a material in air, it takes only 10 raised to minus 6 seconds to accumulate one impurity layer on the surface. If the sticking coefficient is 1, means that if oxygen or moisture hits the surface and it gets stuck. So it takes 10 raised to minus 6 seconds to get a 1 layer. So you actually need to clean the material, to expose the inside of the material and do the measurement. And so the ultra-high vacuum is extremely important. We use 10 raised to minus 11 torr or so, which helps us to keep the sample once the clean surface is exposed. For some hours, of course, it depends on the reactivity of the material. And many cases, many people they are looking at nowadays. I think a lot of people talk about ambient pressure spectroscopy, X-ray photoemission spectroscopy. If you are using this standard laboratory source, I don't really believe that this kind of technique is good. Many people use it, publish in high impact journals. But I have my reservation. But of course, recently I have been also part of a proposal in PETRA where hard X-ray photoemission is used for ambient spectroscopy, which is good because if you are using hard X-ray like 6 kilo electron volt or so, then your penetration depth becomes something like 40 to 50 angstrom, and you are able to look at the inside of the material even if you have impurities on the surface. Many of you might have seen my lab. But I just want to flash our lab, which is essentially designed and built here. Of course, the detectors, photon sources, pumps, we have bought from outside. But all these steels that you are seeing here are designed by us and built locally. There is a Pune company who is now building routinely ultra-high vacuum system. Actually, they got confident after building this. They formed a new company called Corvac. So most of these, many of our colleagues, they are making high quality USB system from them. So the good thing about this is that we are able to detect electrons with extremely high resolution, which is close to 1 millivolt, which is basically around the best that people have achieved so far. Of course, if you use laser source, you can go even lower resolution, which is something like micro. So it's about half a millielectron volt or so, something like that. But most of the studies that is happening today, they are the kind of resolution that we use for RPS is of the order of 5 to 10 millielectron volt. I mean, we need to make it worse because we want to detect more electrons. Otherwise, the intensity is pretty low. In XPS, of course, we have a resolution of 300 millivolt. If you go to synchrotron, it can be improved. But in the lab source, this is pretty low. Let me tell you, give you one or two examples why such high resolution is important before I go to the main topic that we are proposing. This is one example where this is a BAIROC, one of the initial material that we have looked at. This is an insulator. And you can see that the crystal structure is such that the electron can move in this direction pretty easily, but in XY plane, the mobility is limited. So there is a lot of anisotropy. The thing that attracted our attention is the resistivity. As you know Ohm's law, that the current is proportional to the voltage that you apply across the sample. Here, we are plotting current against voltage, and you see that below a certain temperature, it shows an anomaly. So above this, it's almost going somewhat linear, but below 170 Kelvin, it goes up, and then suddenly at certain voltage, it goes back, and then goes like this. If you look at along C direction, this is in AB plane, C direction is much more stronger. So this kind of anomaly, so why it shows? In an insulator, it's completely unusual. In a metallic system, of course, you can have, if you have the scenario like this. So for example, if you have a one-dimensional solid with lattice constant A, if there is a distortion, so which makes the lattice constant higher than A, the periodicity is different, like this kind of distortion which makes it 2A, or if you have a magnetic ordering, antiferromagnetic ordering, which makes the lattice periodicity say instead of A to 2A, because you can see the downspin is seen here. So then the band structure will change. It gets modified because you know that band structure is plotted energy as a function of K, and the Brillouin zone boundary, which is the which is actually plotted as a function of K, which is inverse of this distance in the real space. So now if A becomes 2A, the Brillouin zone boundary will go from pi by A to pi by 2A. Okay. Now at the boundary, because of this symmetry, okay, it opens up a gap because of the supercell symmetry. This, I mean, we can show it. This is a typical solid state effect. Now, if you have a half filled band, okay, now you can see that because of this distortion, the electrons which are there at the Fermi level actually lowers its energy by opening a gap. Okay. So that's the reason the ground state at low temperature actually becomes an insulator, and at high temperature, because of the thermal effect, of course, this effect gets neutralized and you get metallicity. So in this scenario, you can have this kind of resistivity anomaly. You can have a spin density wave and gives you resistivity anomaly. But BAIRO3 is an insulator. So why it shows this behavior? Because there is nothing at the Fermi level, there is nothing to lower its energy. If you do high resolution photo emission, we find that even if it is an insulator at room temperature, there are some density of states at the Fermi level. You can see that this is a spectrum in silver, which shows this typical Fermi-Dirac kind of distribution as a function of temperature. Now you see in this material, you have the spectrum like this, and if you go to lower temperature, it goes to a higher binding energy, opening up a gap. So what we found, and this is possible because of the high resolution, like 2 millivolt that we have used. So if you use a higher resolution, I mean, resolution broadening is higher, then you cannot really detect this kind of small features. And this shows that you actually have some localized states at the Fermi level, although it's an insulator. And this localization can happen in one dimension because of small disorder and so on. That leads to this kind of anomalies. Okay. The another example which I want to show you, many people, I think, looking at quantum dots and so on. So there you use materials like non-magnetic materials like zinc oxide and so on, and it shows ferromagnetic behavior. Nobody knows why it is showing. But if you do magnetization measurement, you see typical hysteresis loop. So we were trying to address one such problem. So here we have used calcium hexaboride, where calcium is non-magnetic. There is no magnetic moment. Boron is non-magnetic, but still it shows a hysteresis loop. So if you do a careful photo emission, okay. So what you see, this is the silver spectrum. This is lanthanum hexaboride or lab 6, which is used as a filament. And many of the experimentalists, they know that this is a good metal. And it shows this kind of behavior, which is somewhat similar like silver. But calcium hexaboride shows a very different behavior. Now, I'm not going into the details. What I'm trying to say is that if you subtract the Fermi-Dirac part, okay, which comes from the metallicity, you see a peak below the Fermi level, which is 20 millivolt and 40 millivolt. And this gives you a localized electrons. Now, if an electron is highly mobile, its spin is distributed, so you don't really see the magnetic moment. Now, if the electron earns a local character, then you know that its spin is well-defined and you can detect detect them, and that gives you contribute in magnetic moment. So what we see is that this p electron somehow earns some local character, giving rise to this local feature, and that leads to magnetism. So that means if you have a material where there is no magnetic moment, but if you have some kind of a disorder, vacancy, and so on, which actually slows down the electron or affects its itinerancy, it can give you magnetic moment, and that can give you ferromagnetism. Okay. So this is another thing. Now I'll talk about the application of ARPS slowly. So this is one system which we are looking at extremely extensively. So where these are special because these are simple insulators, means you have a conduction band and valence band. Valence band is the highly occupied band. It's like a LUMO in a molecule. And this is, LUMO, HOMO and LUMO, like that. So there is a band gap and the Fermi level is in between. Now, if there is a time reversal symmetry, of course, you get a surface state which shows a special kind of behavior, like their orbital moment and spin moment are locked. This comes especially because of the time reversal symmetry. I'm not going to the details of that, but what I'm trying to say here is that if an electron moves in this direction, and if its spin is up, the electron which is moving in this direction, it must have spin down. So the electron which has up spin cannot move in this direction because of this time reversal symmetry. Because the momentum, if you reverse it, the spin momentum also has to reverse when there is a time reversal symmetry. This is simply like a typical traffic. This is a picture which I received, I think, in WhatsApp from Calcutta, New Town Highway. So it shows like that if a car is moving in this direction, you only see the backlight, which is red color, and the car which is moving in this direction, you see only a front light, which is white. Of course, the one which is moving in this direction, you cannot really flip it and show the front light, because I mean this is not allowed by this rule. Okay, so this actually gives you a special kind of situation, because if you have an impurity which wants to scatter this electron, it cannot scatter because it has to flip its spin. Okay, so that's the reason if an electron moves in this direction, it continues to move. Okay? And it gives you a special state which are called Dirac fermions. Okay, and you get a Dirac one like that. But if you look at the experiment, you see that this is a Bi2Ac3, which we have studied extensively in our lab. And you see that if you clip, these are the Dirac states, which looks like the shadow, and these are the bulk states. So inside the gap, you see these Dirac fermions. And their energy actually is sensitive to the surface that you expose. Okay? And we have studied various effects. And nowadays, a lot of people are talking about superconductivity in these materials. This BIPT that we looked at and collaborated with Professor Ramakrishnan is essentially in that spirit, that it's supposed to be a topological superconductor, and one could realize Majorana fermions and various other exotic things if it is truly a topological superconductor. But of course, it turned out that it's not a topological superconductor. Many people use magnetic impurities and open up a gap. And the moment it opens up a gap, of course, you call it heavy fermions or heavy Dirac fermions or massive Dirac fermions. A lot of work is going on. We are also looking at that. Let me now, in last 10 minutes, come to the topic that I am going to focus more in today's topic. So, as you know, that superconductivity is a really unresolved problem for many decades. Of course, after the discovery of superconductivity, then there are theories, which is called BCS theory, where it has been understood that if there is electron-phonon coupling, that leads to Cooper pair. And of course, once those pairs form a coherent state, you get superconductivity, where the electron conducts without any impedance, okay, or resistivity is zero. So this theory is called BCS theory. Any material follows this kind of properties. They are called conventional superconductors. But later, in 1980s or so, a new class of materials which are found, which are cuprates, which show superconductivity at a much higher temperature, and none of them actually can be explained using this BCS theory. So these materials are called unconventional superconductor because it doesn't really follow the conventional theory that has been known so far. But of course, it is understood that you need to have Cooper pairs to have this kind of exotic ground state. Okay? Now, these materials, of course, has thrown up much more challenges in addition to this superconductivity, which is already unresolved. For example, this is a typical cuprate superconductor, where the electron actually moves in this two-dimensional plane because of the structure. They have no connectivity in the C direction. So most of the high temperature superconductors are actually interestingly two-dimensional of this kind. Okay. Now, if you these are essentially antiferromagnetic insulator, and now if you dope electrons or holes, you can make them superconducting. Now the superconducting transition temperature shows like this as a function of dopants. It can be holes or electrons, but usually a typical behavior is like this. But the strangeness of these materials is that even when they are not superconducting, they show a strange kind of behavior which is not understood yet, and which actually thrown up much more puzzle. Why it is puzzling? Just one thing I can tell you is that in the normal metal, you know that the Fermi surface would look like this, which is a closed volume. Fermi surface essentially encloses the number of K points which are corresponding to each of the eigenstate in a solid. Okay? It can enclose a set of points which are unoccupied, it can enclose a set of points which are occupied, whatever it is, it's a closed contour. Okay, that's always you find out if you plot them in the whole extended Brillouin zone. But what happens is that if you cool down these materials below this line, suddenly they show up like an arc, okay, which are not connected. Now nobody really knows why it is like that. Is it that the Fermi surface will be like this, which has no connectivity and so on? It's not understood. There are many theories which are there. I'm not going into the details of that. Some people, they see that whatever people see in photo emission is actually part of it, because the matrix element that I've talked about is doesn't allow the other states to look at it. I don't know. I mean, there are a lot of debates going on. Let's not get into that. But this is a big puzzle that has been addressed several times. And this is the pseudo gap phase that I talk about. In this case, you don't have pseudo gap phase, but they are also good Fermi liquid. But here, you get again metallicity, which are strange. There are some strange behavior. Let's don't go into that now. After that, recently there is a huge amount of emphasis is given on iron-based superconductors. Iron, you know, that it's a highly magnetic element. It's extremely unusual to give a superconductivity because you know that superconductivity doesn't like magnetism. So they don't really go along together. So that's the reason, and you see that superconductivity at a pretty high temperature in these iron-based systems that has thrown up additional challenge. And these materials, they are not insulating like this, but they are also two-dimensional like this. And they have antiferromagnetic order, which is a spin density wave, and you have the superconducting dome. Okay? The pseudo gap phase is not discovered yet because it's much more complex, and that's the reason we had to propose this new method that I'm talking about now. Now, so it has been realized, or many people are talking about the capturing the properties using this electron-electron Coulomb repulsion and the exchange interaction strain, because people believe that these two are actually the playing role in this. Then what about electron phonon coupling, which is in in the conventional superconductor? I just want to quote one thing by Anderson, which he says that U is actually very, very strong, which is some electron hole. J also is pretty strong, so which attracts two electron at the neighboring side. U actually repel two electrons at the same site, and they think that these two are actually responsible for the properties of this material. And this cartoon says that if we have a mammoth and an elephant in a refrigerator, do we really care about the mouse, like the phonons, which is much lower in energy? Okay, so it's probably the particle asymmetry may be important for this kind of material. Now let's look at little bit about the properties of some of these. Say calcium iron to arsenic 2, which is a typical iron superconductor. If you apply pressure, it shows superconductivity. Now, the interesting thing is that there are many experiments I've gone through, and people think that if you apply a hydrostatic pressure, probably you don't get superconductivity. But if it is non-hydrostatic, then probably you get superconductivity. There are a lot of confusions. Now, I'll show you another example where this europium iron to arsenic group. There, it seems that if you have a non-hydrostatic pressure, you don't get superconductivity, but the other way around, it is possible because you apply pressure and you get superconductivity. The additional complexity is that here you have a superconducting phase, okay, and you see that there is an antiferromagnetic ordering. So both of them, they stay together. Now the question is that then do we really need to rethink about the microscopic origin of this phenomena or what exactly is happening? Is there a two different phase space coexisting, but they're not linked together and so on? The other aspect is that normally this material has a structure tetragonal where you have a four-fold rotational symmetry or C4 symmetry is preserved. Now, if you cool down, it becomes orthorhombic. So this four-fold rotational symmetry is broken, which often people talk about like pneumaticity because this rotational symmetry is lowered. You know, I mean, pneumatic phase in liquid crystals and so on, one can correlate to that. But when it becomes superconducting, it appears that by application of pressure, then this four-pole symmetry is preserved. Like in cuprates also, you do have a four-pole symmetry. It appears that this two-dimensionality or four-pole symmetry might be important. So there are a lot of phase diagram has come out. Let me not go into this because the time is up. So there are different proposals like maybe the spin fluctuation, charge fluctuation, pneumatic fluctuation, these are the ones could be responsible. Nothing is really understood. So we thought let's look at it using time resolve RPS. Now, little bit on the band structure of say calcium iron to arsenic 2. You have three bands forming. So in cuprate, it was a simple system because you have only one band crossing the Fermi level, which is dx square minus y square. Okay. So you can use single band model and study the problem. Still, it's not resolved. Iron based systems, you have much more complexity because you have many bands crosses problem. So these are dxy, yz, and zx orbitals. They form this. So these are called hole pockets because if you form a contour, it encloses all the k points which are unoccupied. Okay. And here you have electron pockets where the enclosed volume contains all the occupied k points. Okay. So this electron pocket hole, so there are three hole pockets, there are two electron pockets on the Fermi surface, which is shown here. And of course, there is a kind of a symmetry associated to one of them with one of them. Here gives you superconductivity, which is for nesting. I'm not getting into the details of this. So what I would like to say is that if you do a careful RPS study, what I can say that all the bands that we get calculated can be found out from the experiment. These are our results. And if you go to spin density wave state, you see that one of the band opens up a gap, which I have shown initially when we are talking about the magnetic ordering or spin density wave. See, if you go to low temperature, it opens up again. But still, there are two bands crossing the Fermi level. So what basically is happening? So we thought that let's do time resolve on this. So this is basically the setup, which is there in Slovenia, where one of my students went as a postdoc, and now one is doing PhD there. So basically, the work is led by these two guys. So you have a titanium sapphire laser and you have a beam splitter. A small fraction of it goes through a delay stage and you focus it on the sample here in your USB chamber, which is called pump laser. And the major part of this light actually goes through a gas cell where you generate higher harmonics. And then there is a monochromator and you use, so we generate higher harmonics because for photo emission, you need to have photon which is much higher than the work function. And of course, if you want to get this free electron kind of behavior, which is beyond this band structure effect, you need to have at least 20 electron volt. So that we generate by higher harmonics and then select one of the photon and probe the system. So what you do is that you use a pump pulse, excite the sample, and then take a snapshot using the probe plus pulse using this detector. So that's the thing. So here, I'll again go back to the matrix element that I have shown there. And let's use the last part, the symmetry selection rule. Okay. So assume that this is your sample, this is the x-axis and y-axis, which is in plane, and the z-axis on which you have the detector. If the light comes, which is inside this xz plane, so we can say that xz plane is the photoemission plane. Okay. Now electrons are detected where the detector is placed on the xz plane or photoemission plane. So we can just think that this IF is an even function. Now, if you have this integral and it needs to have non-zero value, it needs to have these two parts also even, because the whole thing, if it is even, then only it has non-zero. If it is an odd function, you take integral, it becomes zero. Okay. So that means that if psi f is even, so now I'm probing, say, dxz and yz and dxy. So the wave function, which is odd, like dxy and yz with respect to xz plane, will give you contribution if the light polarization is out of plane, which is the odd function. So that means that if you have a polarization vector which is S polarized, S means that it's aligned with the surface of the sample, so which is perpendicular to the photo emission plane, you actually probe dxy and yz from this argument. Okay. And if you want to probe xz, dxz, you need to have polarization in plane. Okay. This argument has been used extensively by many people and trying to find out the symmetry of the states that you are detecting from photo emission. And the idea was that let's detect symmetry of the electrons that you are probing and see if you are able to identify electrons from different bands. Here I show one of our results. There are many groups. I mean, nowadays, although time resolved RPS is not so popular like RPS yet, but many groups are setting up their lab for time resolved RPS. And those who are really working, so they actually have used this kind of technique and they really didn't find anything. Okay. Here I show why they didn't find. You see that you have used a pump pulse and you use S polarized and P polarized probe pulse, and this is the signal. These oscillations that you see, these are true signal. It happens because, you know, in a solid, you have these vibrations, atomic vibrations. So that gives you a change in overlap integral. So that actually leads to a shift of the Fermi level. So the moment they are more hybridized, wherever you have the Fermi level, if they go away, the Fermi level is different. So that way the intensity at a particular energy changes. And this is detected, this is an integral intensity between 0.1 to 0.2 electron volt above the Fermi level in the unoccupied part. So that gives you these oscillations. You can actually look at the oscillation more carefully and find out what is the vibrational frequencies and so on. Our aim is not that. We just wanted to look at the decay. And you see that the decay and also the oscillations looks almost identical. So it's not working. So we thought, this is actually within Ganesh, who actually has really carried it out efficiently. We thought that let's use a different technique. Now, this excited states that we have in between after pump excitation, this is the complete, black hole kind of thing. You don't really know anything about it because, for example, if you have a molecule and you go to the excited states, this time resolved studies are done. And there you can, of course, do the calculations and trying to find out. A lot of people are looking at it, but in solid, it's a completely unknown world. So what we thought that let's align the electric field of the incident beam along one of the loop. You know that whenever you are perturbing the system with a light, of course, this electric field introduces oscillation among the electrons. And if it is aligned along one of the loop, it's able to excite. If it is out of plane of this lobe, it cannot excite that electron. This is the dichroism, of course, used in various molecules and so on. Those who are doing chemistry, of course, they know. So we thought that let's try that and use a polarized pump pulse. We don't know the final state, of course, after the excitation, but let's see if we can find out anything out of that. So that way, we use A aligned along y-axis, so that doesn't give you excitation for this. And if you have P polarized light, it excites dxz orbitals and so on. Okay, so that's the way we thought that we'll study. And now here I have shown two different setups. And now when you are using the pump pulse, which is S polarized, you are exciting essentially dxy and yz. And if you're using S P polarized light, you are primarily exciting dzx. Of course, there will be some component for this. But the maximum component will come from these electrons. And if you look at the band structure, we can, of course, we know that there are three bands and their characters we know from calculation. Of course, the calculation and the true electronic structure, they differ. But most of the time, we have seen that close to the Fermi level, the description are quite well, and it can be captured well by EFTs. Okay. So this is basically the thing that we have done. And look at the spectrum here. So here I have done plotted as a function of K, the intensity. This is the Fermi level. And you see that if you use depolarized light within this red box, I don't know if you're able to see, the intensity here is much more compared to here. But if you use S-polarized, they are uniformly distributed. I have shown here the, by integrating them. And you see that for red and blue box, which is the red and blue color, they look almost identical if you have S-polarized light. But they are very different. The red is much more deeper compared to the blue if you have a P-polarized light. Now, these red blocks actually correspond to this band, and the blue box correspond to this band. Okay? This we have done from ARPES. So these are the well-defined things. And now, if you look at the decay, you see that the decay is changing if you have a different polarized light. And we have found out this is a kind of a nice discovery, I would say, that if you use P-polarized light and look at their decay time, and you see that the decay is actually happening at a much smaller time scale compared to the S-polarized light, where you have a 2 picosecond almost, you see. Now, S-polarized light actually has a contribution which is dominant coming from BXY, okay, which is localized electrons, because you know that this is the structure. So this is the iron and these are the arsenic. So DXY is in this XY plane. They have a hybridization pretty weak compared with respect to this arsenic P. So that way they are really not dispersing so well. So if you have an electron in XY band or XY orbital, they cannot go so easily to here because the hybridization is weak. But if you have an XZ and YZ electron, they have a strong hybridization because they can hop to arsenic and come. So there is a pathway available. So they are itinerant. And we see that if you have an electron which is itinerant, they actually decay much faster compared to the electron which is local. Okay. Now, if you go to lower temperature, where there is an antiferromagnetic order sets up, because of the antiferromagnetic order, you are opening up a gap, and you see the time scale becomes higher. Okay. So slight increase. So it matches with our story that if you have a local electron. So this is little difficult to think of, because whenever we talk about local electron, we always talk about electron-electron repulsion, which localizes electron. So that means that electrons are interacting with other electrons. So they are more interacting electrons, so they should have actually lost energy much faster compared to others. But here, I'm talking about localization in terms of itinerancy, okay? This electron-electron interaction happens much faster, and maybe at a sub-second time scale. We are not able to really catch them. What we are looking at,
just a quick question, the beating patterns in your decay data, could you tell me what that origin is?
Sorry?
The beating patterns you see, the quantum beats you see.
This is the phonon oscillator.
Phonons, the coupling to the phonons.
Yes.
So you could do...
This you can find, we have...
Raman. Like it will amount to be Fourier transform to be a Raman.
Yeah. These people have done Raman, and you can actually find out the frequency and match it.
Yes.
It matches exactly.
Okay.
Actually, this actually gives you that which mode is connected to the electron excitation. This electron phonon coupling. When you do Raman, you get many peaks corresponding to various vibrations. So here, all of them are not really linked to electron excitation. Yes.
Only the projected, the ones that are projected are coupled to the electron.
Absolutely, you are right. Yeah, and that's the way that has been done already. So we can also do it by extracting that. But the main thing is that we are able to say that if you have this weaker electron phonon coupling, like or the electrons are localized, they actually stay at an excited state much longer. So this is more like an orbital selective kind of behavior. A lot of people are talking about orbital selective modulus and various other things, orbital selective behavior. This gives you the first experimental finding about orbital selective behavior, because you are able to actually detect them. As you know that we were pretty excited, and of course it went through many rounds in PRL, but somehow we don't have the calculation to really support, because it's very difficult to calculate the intermediate states, the excited states. We are talking to various theoreticians, and we also might develop ourselves, see how, with collaboration with various theoreticians, and see what is happening. But eventually it got published, so in PRB. The next one is even more interesting. So this is basically one slide before I conclude, is that so here, this is a calcium iron to arsenic 2, which I have shown earlier. So this one at room temperature, of course, it's paramagnet. Below 170 Kelvin, it becomes a spin density wave. Now, if you do the experiment with this two polarization, I'm looking at pretty close to the absorption A. This T equal to zero. Okay. So 200 K, both the polarization looks identical. But if you go to 150 Kelvin, which is a SDW kind of feature, so there you see that the P polarized light gives you a peak, but S polarized doesn't give you such a enhanced peak. See, almost not there. But of course, S polarized light also will excite partly some DXZ electrons, which are magnetically ordered. So this clearly shows that you are actually exciting magnetic electrons, which gives you an depolarized light, but without exciting the other electrons, okay? Which is done by S polarized light. You see, S polarized light gives you all the other electrons excitations, which are also seen in P polarized light, which happens at 200 femtosecond. But you can do that separately. This is the thing which, now what is the proof that is happening this way? So I want to show you here, focus on this, okay? So you see that this is the spectral function at room 200 Kelvin. Now if you go to the antiferromagnetic phase, it gives you this peak, which shows a gap of the order of, say here it is 35 milli electron volt. So the gap is of the order of 70. So we are looking at only below the Fermi level, so which is 35. So now if you use S polarized light, the spectrum looks like the red line. And you need to shift and see that it matches with the higher temperature data. But if you use P polarized light, you see that the red light, the gap is not there anymore. So you have destroyed the gap. It means that you are able to destroy the magnetic order selectively by using polarized light, which was not possible so far. So which also tells you that you are able to actually selectively excite electrons and destroy or selectively pick up certain kind of parameter, order parameter, without disturbing the other order. It's an extremely powerful technique. We are extremely excited about it. Here I have plotted the electron, effective electron temperature. This you can calculate easily, because you know that the spectral function, if you know, you can fit the spectral function using an effective Fermi-Dirac distribution function. So the temperature that requires to fit this function is the effective electron temperature. That's the way we calculate. And you see that if you are in the paramagnetic phase, the drain looks identical for both the polarization. Of course, the P polarized light seem to heat up the system much more efficiently compared to the S polarized light. But if you go to the magnetically ordered phase, you can see that you have a peak at a 50 femtosecond time scale, which is not there in S polarized case. So the S polarized case, which is sensitive to the phonon excitations, happens close to 200. Okay. So that means that this suggests two important things. One is that as far as the technique is concerned, that we are able to selectively heat up electrons without heating up the other electrons, okay, which is really not possible by anything else. Second thing is that actually the magnetic order that we have seen may not be linked to the other properties. So they are probably occupying a different phase space. So this coexistence of superconductivity and magnetism that we are talking about, we have to look at those systems more carefully, but they may not be too exclusive region of the Brillouin zone that is spanning. Okay, so that's the thing. So the conclusion from this is that we are, this is a new proposal, of course. It has to come up much bigger way, I believe. So we are able to detect selectively, detect the behavior of the electron selectively, and which might be relevant for this orbital selective motness or orbital selective behavior of the complex materials. The other surprising, or maybe the interesting thing, I would say that the local electrons seem to have a longer lifetime compared to the itinerant electrons, which is intuitively can be understood because they have a much more decay channels to lose out energies and come relax back. And the other conclusion is that magnetization is possible without probably the breaking. This is a very strong claim. Okay? I believe that it's correct, but we have to, of course, do much more experiment to get into this. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Maiti, for a very very nice talk. And I really thought that there are certain sections which were done from the very fundamentals, like the selection rules and also the initial description of the photoelectron spectroscopy part. Thank you for doing that, Kalada. This was helpful to lots of people, I'm sure. So let us ask the audience if there are questions. There is one on the chat box that Uttam has asked. Mm-hmm. Isn't it obvious a polarized laser light always produces selective excitation?
Absolutely, it is obvious, because that's the thing. The main problem is that you have to link these excited electrons to the electrons that we are probing. Okay. Now, when you are exciting, of course you are exciting. So when you have a light polarization aligned along the lobe, as I mentioned, this dichromism is known for decades, which is used. So you are exciting electrons selectively, but when it goes into the excited states, so you have associated electron-phonon coupling, electron-magnon coupling, and it loses its symmetry. Okay. Now, how this excitation is linked to the information that we are getting from the probe pulse. Okay. That's basically the problem. So this is the one where there is a lot of apprehensions, and we are trying to push that actually that is linked, because you have nothing else essentially to give you signal from the probe pulse, but people are not really accepting it. So we have to give much more. But experimentally, of course, it's a robust experimental observation.
Okay. Questions? Well, if there are no, so I have one question with respect to the last data set in the time resolved part that you showed. You said that when you look at this relaxation of these electrons, right, using the ARPIS method, you also capture some phonons. So could you shed some light on what specific phonons? Is there a specific symmetry that you see associated with it? So yeah,
yes,
could you elaborate on that?
I don't really remember. I think it's the easy symmetry electrons which are actually getting probed. So what we do is that we can actually extract the oscillations that we have in our ARPIS signal. Okay. And then you can do Fourier transform and find out what is the energy. And that is actually matched with the calculations of various phonons, excitations, or you can match with the Raman spectrum. And I guess it's a easy electrons, but at the moment, I don't remember. But it has been found. I think the energy is of the order of 76 milli electron volts.
Right.
This has been extracted, so we didn't.
So this is with respect to the those modes that are directly coupled to the emission, photo emission.
Yes.
Okay. So in principle, this can be very similar to what electronic excited state emission from electronic excited states in molecules, where you also have parallels to this, right?
Absolutely. It is similar because it is essentially emission of electrons.
Electrons.
Is happening and we are detecting them. Right. So it is similar, absolutely. But the thing is that the complexity here is that when you have molecules, you have well defined, I mean, various things which are pretty defined, and you can calculate them pretty well. But in solid, it's very complex because you have the electrons. There is a translational symmetry that makes you bands, and there are various other things. So that makes enhances complexity. So that's the.
So my trivial question is, why then ARPS is required? You could have done it with a regular conventional pump probe also, where you could have identified the channels, phonon channels for this relaxation.
Okay, ARPS is basically to identify the bands that we want.
The bands.
Yeah. So the you have three hole pockets. Yes. I told you that one of them is involved in antiferromagnetic hardening. Other two, of course, definitely playing some role, maybe playing some role in superconductivity. But if you want to identify those bands, then you need ARPS.
Okay.
Otherwise, angle integrated spectrum is good enough, of course.
Just good enough. Okay, fine. Thank you, Kaloda. Any other question? Okay. Well, if there are no more questions, let's thank Professor Kalaburun Maithi for a fantastic talk again. And I would also tell the audience that a special thanks to Mistry, Rajesh Mistry and his team for keeping the lecture theater on. At some point next month, we will start the sort of a tea session after the colloquium, where people can gather outside the West Canteen, just on the open air, and just discuss with the speaker, if the speaker is local, and if not, then just discuss amongst themselves and have some bit of snacks and tea, okay? So I promise that we are going to start that next month. The colloquium next week is not there on account of a pan-TIFR chemistry meeting. So we are not being able to organize a colloquium during that time, but we will resume with Professor Shurojit Dhara, who is this year's Bhatnagar awardee in physics, in physical sciences, and he is going to talk about very interesting pneumatic crystals and liquid crystals. So till then, I wish all of you stay healthy, okay? As we have a second round coming up, so second wave of this COVID coming up. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you, Kalaburun.